Assalamu alaikum and welcome to part 3 of Ayah 56 from Surah 33 of Al-Ahzab. And I will start with sex in the city of Al-Madina. Because if there is one thing that has plagued Al-Madina at the time of the Messenger, that is sex. Both people committing it and people selling it. The Messenger of Allah was very aware of this problem. And the story that he stoned people to death because of that is absolutely rubbish. There is no stoning, nothing. The Quran has called for the lashing of 100 times, and again he put the rules where you can apply this law. 4 people must witness the act of sexuality, and there has to be a penetration. Kissing, touching, things like that are not considered as a crime back then. So the Messenger of Allah was aware of this problem. But because of his status and the whole situation of Al-Madina and him being a minority, he didn't want to start changing the rules in the whole city. But also he didn't know what to do with it and how to deal with it. The believers with him were fornicating with non-Muslim women. The Muslim women were prostitution to make a living. If something happens, they say, Ya Rasulullah, how can we make a living? Give us money. He's not rich. He doesn't have money. And all it's complicated from all angles. Well, it is at this time that Allah has stepped in. But as I said earlier on, the people, when the believers started pushing their own girls, the slave girls that committing prostitution, and when Allah has said that the fornicating woman and the fornicating man flog each one of them 100 stripes, and there must not be any pity for them when you hold that, and this must be done in front of a group of people. Why? So that Allah cuts down from this prostitution. Well, if you go back, or when you look at the Quran and the books of that, you will find that the surahs as classified today, for example, Al-Fatiha is number 1, Baqarah number 2, Ali Imran 3, Nisa 4, and so on and so forth, all this ranking was done by Uthman. This is not how the Quran was revealed. Even the ayat within the surah, they were decided by Uthman and his people. And after all, Uthman was killed. The third Khalifa, Uthman ibn Affan, who came after Umar ibn Khattab, was killed because of what he did to the Quran. Of course, our books of history tell something else, but that's exactly why he was killed. When you look at how they classified Surah An-Nur and Surah Al-Ahzab in the Quran, you will find that Surah An-Nur was revealed after Surah Al-Ahzab. In the order of their revelation, An-Nur came after Surah Al-Ahzab. Even though the ranking in the Quran, they put Surah An-Nur before Surah Al-Ahzab. It should have been the opposite, because as we read history, we should know first what happened in Surah Al-Ahzab, then we move on to Surah An-Nur. But now they put Surah An-Nur. It's like you're telling a story to somebody, you tell them what happened in year 10, and then you tell them what happened in year 1. It doesn't happen. The event who took care in year 1 must be known, and then the events who took care in year 10 must be known. As it's the opposite. Surah An-Nur was revealed after Surah Al-Ahzab, but guess what? They put it in front of Surah Al-Ahzab. So when you start studying, you have no idea what you are reading. Unless you know this piece of history, then you go to Surah An-Nur, put it before, after Surah Al-Ahzab, and you go, oh, okay, that's how it happens. So you put Surah Al-Ahzab first, Surah An-Nur comes first. Second, Surah An-Nur in the ranking when it was revealed of the 114th surah of the Quran, Surah An-Nur was ranked 103rd. So it was the 103rd surah that was revealed, yet in the Quran they put her surah number 24. While Surah Al-Ahzab was 90th. In the ranking of revelation, Surah Al-Ahzab came first. So between Surah Al-Ahzab and Surah An-Nur, there were 13 other surahs. So because Surah Al-Ahzab is 90, Surah An-Nur is 103. But the sad thing is, when you put them in the Quran, Surah An-Nur is 24 and Surah Al-Ahzab is 33. And this is a problem. Because Surah Al-Ahzab presented the problems of the sexual promiscuity and the debauchery in Al-Madina, and Surah An-Nur later on when it came, it came to resolve the problems. But no, for Surah An-Nur we start seeing the solutions, then later on in Surah Al-Ahzab we see the problem. And that has created a big confusion, and that's the sad news. People, the people in Al-Madina didn't have respect for anybody. The non-believers, the young man, used to chase girls like crazy. Nothing has changed. The, what they call them, the skirt chasers have always existed. The predators, the sexual predators have always existed. At the time of Al-Madina, time of the messenger, people in Al-Madina suddenly saw a big number of new girls come into town, and these girls didn't have food to eat, they didn't have where to live. And then, what did they do? They started offering money to these girls against sex. Guess what? A woman in need, she might refuse one day, she might refuse 2 days, 3 days, but they will come one day and you catch her at her weakest. And she will accept the money because other her children will die out of hunger, or maybe she won't have a place, and she can rationalize this in so many different ways. And that's how prostitutions started spreading in the midst of the Muslims. When that started happening, some of the people, the believers as well, were doing that. Okay, I work here a day, I go to work in the fields, I make a couple dinars, whatever money at that time, and then they would go for sex, either with someone who doesn't believe in Al-Madina or with another Muslim woman. The Prophet, as I said, was extremely aware of what was happening in his time. But the problem that was going to face him was unlike any other one. People were chatting up girls in the street. And of the girls that were chatted up in the streets were the wives of the messenger himself. Yes. And guess who was chatting them up? Not the disbelievers of Al-Madina, but people who believed in the messenger. People who believed in the messenger, they were chatting up his wives. But the problem, the messenger now, and when Allah spoke in the Quran, He spoke about the wives of the messenger. He didn't single out one or two or three of them. He spoke about them as a bunch. So when I speak about them now, I will speak about them as a bunch. I don't care who it was. Allah says the wives of the messenger, it means the wives of the messenger were. If it was only one or two of them, Allah would have said, and of the wives of the messenger. We understand not all of them. But since Allah has used the wives, all of the wives of the messenger were flirtatious. Yes, I know it pains you to hear that, but it's one of the two. It's either we accept what the Quran says, or we reject it and we carry on living with the hadith where it made the wives of the Prophet the most chaste women on earth, when in fact they were not. And the Prophet Muhammad and his wives weren't immune from those problems and the sexual debauchery and promiscuity. Those sexual predators started chasing the wives of the messenger. The problem is, the wives of the messenger were enjoying the attention. The wives of the messenger were flirtatious. The wives of the messenger allowed this to take place. And Allah got angry, because He was looking, Allah was seeing what was going on, what was happening to His Prophet. And the Prophet was completely useless. Do you know why? Because if the Prophet started talking to people, why are you talking to my wife? People start saying, what's this man? Oh, you doubt it? What, you think your wife is Marilyn Monroe? You think like she's the sexiest thing in town? What's wrong with you? You accuse us? And then guess what? We all might wave bye-bye to Islam. But because of his status as a prophet and messenger of Allah, even though the Prophet was seeing his wife being flirtatious, and he knew that other people were chatting up his wives, and he knew his wives weren't doing the job properly at rejecting this man and they enjoyed the attention, he couldn't do anything. And this is why Allah stepped in. He tells them, Ya Nisa al-Nabi, you wives of the Prophet, لَسْتُنَّكَ أَحَدٍ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ, you are not like any of the other women. Your status is not like any other. Why? It's not because they married to Muhammad. No. It's because they are married to the Messenger of Allah. Any attack on the Messenger of Allah is directly linked to the attack on Allah and the Quran. All you need is a rumor against the Messenger of Allah and you might say bye-bye to Islam for eternity. That's why the status of the wives of Rasulullah can play a dangerous, destructive role in this religion of Allah. And that's why he tells them, you are not like any other of the other women. Nowhere, you are not like that. And then he tells them, in ittaqaytun, if you are to fear Allah as he wants you to, فَلَا تَخْضَعْنَا بِالْقَوْلِ, then do not submit with your speech. The way you talk to men, like very sexy, provocative, very sensual. Allah says, do not submit with your speech. When you read the translations, if you go now to the internet, to the Quran.com, and open on this ayah here in Surah Al-Ahzab, you will find the translators. They did everything in their ability, in their power, to translate the term takhdan, which in Arabic means submit to. They used any other word except what Allah wants. Why? Because in the books of history, in the hadith, they portrayed the wives of the Prophet as perfect. They can't say that the wives of the Prophet were flirtatious, they were this, and they submitted to other foreign men. They can't say that. It will go against the hadith. But they chose to go against the hadith and not speak what the Quran said. So they translated something like this. The submit to, with your voice, they translated, do not speak too softly. Don't be too soft in your speech. Don't be not soft in your speech. Then be not soft in your speech. Do not be too soft in your speech. Do not be too subdued in of speech. Do not be too complacent in your speech. Do not speak too softly. Be not too complacent. You see how they go right, left, but they don't use the term submit. Submission with speech, as you can see, and all the translators have done incredible job at avoiding that term, because what they did, these translators, is they shifted the blame away from the wives themselves to how they spoke, to their voice. Allah didn't tell them, do not speak softly. He told them, do not use your speech in a manner to submit to men. These are two different matters. Because a woman can speak soft, because Allah in the same ayah will order the wives of the Messenger to speak kindly and nicely. But he orders them not to submit to a man. Let me give you an example. Yeah, here in England, you go for whatever business. Let's say, I don't know where you go. What's that? Let's go, you go to the doctors. And the receptionist comes, you speak to her, oh, can I have an appointment? And she gives you an appointment. You go, thank you. And she goes, oh, you're welcome. End of it. She told it to you nicely, kindly. Nothing you read into it. You go out. Now watch this. I come into the reception, I get a little bit flirtatious with the girl so that I can get an appointment. Oh, sweetheart, how are you doing today? Oh, yeah. Oh, you're right. Oh, good, 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 good. Oh, look, I'm looking for an appointment. Oh, can you do it? And then I start being flirtatious. The woman, when she sees me flirtatious, and if she likes me, then she will return the flirt. It's a natural thing within us. Women, you know it, and men, you know it. When someone likes you, they will flirt with you if you flirt with them. So, later on, she gives me the, and I go, oh, you are an angel, thank you. And I go, okay, I'll see you next time. It's time to go, and I say, oh, you have a wonderful day. And she goes, bye, with that singing voice. That singing voice, her tone, everything is flirtatious. That's what the wives of the Messenger were doing. So Allah is telling them, say something good, speak nice. But don't submit with your voice to men. Why? Because the way you talk, people talk to you to flirt with you. When you respond in flirtatious, guess what? They will chase you up. And that's exactly what happened. Allah orders the wives of the Messenger, do not submit with your speech in a manner that makes the sexual predators understand that they are invited to flirt and seduce you, and that they might have a chance to even bed you, take you to bed. This is what Allah is telling the wives of the Messenger. And that's why in the same ayah, this is in Surah Al-Ahzab, ayah 32, before we get to 56, Allah justifies why they should not be flirtatious and submit with their voices. He tells them, فَيَطْمَعَ الَّذِي فِي قَلْبِهِ مَرَضٌ وَقُلْنَا قَوْلًا مَعْرُوفًا, lest he in whose heart is the sexual disease perversion should want and lust, L-U-S-T, when you have a lust after some woman to a man or man to a woman. Allah tells them, don't submit with your voice to avoid that someone in whose heart is a sexual intentions, because when you do that, he will lust after you, he would want you. And then he tells them not to be rude, and that's why he tells them, وَقُلْنَا قَوْلًا مَعْرُوفًا, and do speak kindly in non-sexual manner. This is ayah 33, surah 33 Al-Ahzab in ayah 33. So how could a woman submit to a man with speech? Well, the women, you know that. You see, a woman, most of us have already slept with a partner, man with a woman, woman with a man. The way we talk to each other when we are aroused sexually is not when we talk to each other, when you say, oh, I'm going to do the dishes, or I'm going to take the kids to school. It's two different words altogether. The wives of the messenger used to speak to men in a manner that a woman would talk to a man in the bed. And that's why the sexual predators wanted and always chased the wives of the messenger. So Allah orders the wives of the messenger to stop being flirtatious, because they are not like any other women out there, and their position will affect the religion of Allah. And this is why in another ayah Allah tells them, if something happens to this Islam, Allah will punish you twice, the punishment of any hard punishment on the hereafter. You take the highest man, the person that's going to be punished on Judgment Day, the wives of the messenger will be punished twice that punishment. Then Allah tells them the reason why he prohibited them all these, and how to avoid, why to avoid sexual predators and things like that. He tells them, إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ لِيُذْهِبَ عَنْكُمُ الرِّجْسَ أَهْلَ الْبَيْتِ وَيُطَهِّرَكُمْ تَطْهِيرًا. Allah wishes to remove uncleanliness from you. So the wives of Rasulullah weren't clean sexually. I'm talking here about behavior. They were not clean. So Allah wanted to remove their uncleanness from them and purify them. This is Allah's intention. He intends to purify the wives of the Prophet and keep them away from all kinds and types of sexual predators. The sexual predators, when they saw this, and the wives have changed their behavior and things like that, and when Allah had ordered the wives of the messenger to stay at home and not go out without any purposes so that they don't flirt. It never was for a woman in the 21st century, or much less in the 11th century, to be jailed at home for piety. No, it was for the wives of the messenger, a prophet, so that they don't be flirtatious. That's why Allah ordered them to stay at home. Already? So, now Allah moves on to something else. The wives of the prophet have stopped going outside by the order of Allah, وَقَرْنَ فِي بُيُوتِكُنْ. Stay at home, study the Quran, and learn to be better women. The men outside who used to flirt with them started getting antsy. They started getting panicky. Oh my God, where did she go? And in the Arab countries, when a man starts turning around, like stalking a woman, but in that part of the world, it's okay. You can stalk a woman, no big deal. And so if the woman doesn't show, the man starts getting panicky. Oh my God, what happened to her? Where is she? That kind of stuff. Same thing happened. These men started, oh my God, what happened to them? What are they? Thing like that. So what did they do? They designed a new strategy. Back in time, the houses of Al-Madinah didn't have doors as we know them. Like today, we close your door. Nobody knows what's inside on the other side. Back then, they didn't have the technology to build strong doors or perfect doors or things like that. So it was easy for people to peep through the doors, or even push the door with a finger, and the door opens up and they can see all what is inside, or even walk inside it. Guess what? Those sexual predators designed something. Especially that the Arabs aren't the most educated or polite people on earth, especially their Bedouins, the people who live in the Sahara. You see, the desert is very harsh. And whoever is born in the desert and spends their lives in the desert will become harsh. Just unlike the people near, live near the sea is calm and composed, and so are people. But the desert creates some really, really dangerous people out there. So these people started thinking, how can we reach the wives of the, those sexy wives of the Prophet? How can we get to them? They don't go out anymore. Then go, okay, we got it. And the reason why? Because there are so many of them are obnoxious and so inconsiderate. So what they did, because they know the Prophet was doing his best as for to take care of his followers, they said, you know what, let's join them and let's be of the group of people who need help. So the Prophet started seeing something new. Let's say a group of people, each one of them was flirting with one of the wives. Each of these people started going to the wife they used to flirt with. And at time of lunch or early dinner, they would just walk inside the home of the Prophet. Once inside the rooms, the Prophet didn't have two bedrooms or three bedrooms. He used to have one room for one wife. So when he is inside, it's the place where they sleep, where they eat, where she cooks. Everything was, as we call here in England, one studio. It has every toilet and everything. They would go out in the open, but everything else happened in the room. Imagine now a man who flirts with one of the wives would walk inside the room, and he is alone with the wife of the Prophet. And why are we here? Are you here? Oh, I'm hungry, I can't eat. So that's their excuse. So if the Prophet came at that time, guess what? They're there for food. He can't accuse them of anything else. But guess what? Allah knew what they were doing. Did that stop the wives of the Prophet from not being flirtatious? No, they still carried on. When the men were there, hey, let's carry on with where we were from where we stopped. End of it. So Allah Ta'ala starts notice that this behavior of people has become spread, and now it's not once, it's few times, and it's getting worse. All these people are going to the Prophet is not in his home, he is elsewhere. And when he comes home, he finds men in his room with his wives, 2, 3, 4, 5, you know, the poor people, and they're flirting, chit-chatting the wives. So Allah Ta'ala took the steps to stop this calamity. He says, because always remember, people are observing what the messenger is doing and what's being done to the Prophet. So if the majority of Al-Madinah is not Muslim yet, and they watch how the wives of the messenger are flirtatious, how the believers themselves do not have any respect for the wives, how much of this Islam are you gonna accept? Not much. I wouldn't go to Islam for that reason. So Allah now steps in to resolve the thing. So he issues the first ruling. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, addressing the believers, he tells them, do not enter any houses. La tadkhulu buyutan, do not enter any houses other than your own house until you seek permission. ذَلِكُمْ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَذَكَّرُونَ, that is best for you. So keep this in mind. And this is in Surah An-Nur 24, Ayah 27. It is incredible that Allah had to send down a Quran to tell these Bedouin, these impolite and mannered people, to behave in a respectful, common sense manner. Don't enter a house that is not yours without seeking permission. Allah wouldn't descend a Quran just because somebody did it once. It's because it has become the norm in Al-Madinah, and specifically about the house of the Messenger of Allah. Those who lived, the believers at the time of the Messenger, were not angelic. They were not well-behaved men. They were not respectful to the Messenger of Allah. And the men of religion have lied about it for centuries. They were actually very thick and boldly, and they were bad people. They were bad-mannered people. Allah had to even teach them the very basic of social interactions. He taught them the correct way to approach in people's private accommodation. Don't enter a house until you seek permission. How much knowledge do you need? How much common sense do you need? Then Allah tells them, فَإِن لَمْ تَجِدُوا فِيهَا أَحَدًا فَلَا تَدْخُلُوهَا حَتَّى يُؤْذَنَ لَكُمْ. And if you do not find anyone in them houses, because remember the doors do not shut, they didn't have keys or things like that, Allah tells them, do not enter these houses until permission is given to you. And if there are people in the house and they don't want to see you, and they tell you, go back, Allah tells them, just go back. It's more noble for you. هُوَ أَزْكَى لَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ عَلِيمًا. And Allah is knowing, and He knows very well what you are doing and what you're doing. It really is incredible. Really incredible. What is today for us normal behavior, but to the people that existed with the Prophet, seeking permission to enter and greeting the occupants of a house wasn't a normal behavior. They didn't do it. My dear sisters and my brothers, if you want to know more about these uneducated, unmannered, and unsocial Arabs, go back to the Quran, read An-Nur, Al-Ahzab, Surah An-Nisa, Al-Baqarah, read. It talks, don't believe the hadith, don't believe the sheikhs, don't believe history. They lie to you. The Quran, it tells us that the great number of people that were with the messenger were hypocrites. The Quran has described the companions as a bunch. But anyhow, what our Sunni sheikhs have done, it's a sad thing, is they linked speaking about the truth and reality of the companions to being a Shia. So now people are just scared of talking about them. Why? Because they fear the moment you open your mouth and you speak about the companions, that's a Shia talking. Well, in fact, I am not a Shia, never was, never will. And what I'm doing is saying what the Quran says. I'm not saying anything. If our Sunni sheikhs have decided to hide what the Quran say, I will bring it up, and I'm sure many other people will, and it will continue until the end of this world. I want to speak now about the wives of the Prophet, because they also had their share of misbehaviors when out and about, so much so that Allah had to intervene to stop them from what they were doing. As I earlier said, Allah didn't specify in the Quran which wife or wives He was talking about. He just addressed them as you, the wives of the Prophet. And for that, as I said already, I will speak about them being the wives of the Messenger without pointing at one of them specifically. Even though the books of Hadith and history and everything have made the issue about one woman, Zainab, the one of the wives of the Messenger, who when he married her, something happened. But they lie as usual. Allah was not talking about, otherwise Allah is a liar, because the incident was one wife, and the books of the Hadith and the history and everything have said who she was, while Allah says the wives. So one of the two is not correct. And in this world here, I am going to go with humans being the incorrect ones. So Allah addressed them as a whole, as a team, as one unity that deals with the Messenger of Allah. As I earlier said, the wives of the Messenger used to spend a good portion of their time outside and doing this, shopping, visiting, doing all that kind of what women did there, especially that women at that time, when staying at home, didn't have much to do. But this gave an opportunity to the hunters for sex, who did not differentiate between married women and single woman and slave girl. To them, if she had breasts and walks and has long hair, and if she talks like a woman, walks like a woman, she's good for hunting. So because of this, they did not differentiate between even the wives of the Prophet. To them, a woman was a woman. And the worst thing is, these people were believers. They were not a small portion, because Allah will not speak about a small portion. If He was talking about a small portion, He would have said, وَمِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ, and of the believers. But here He said, the believers. It means a big chunk of them. Now what they do, they would, guess what? Hunt the wives of the Messenger and kill. What these people used to do, they would sit someplace when the girls or the ladies or women would go outside to their toilet needs. These people would sit there to hunt the girls, so they would say, oh, that slave girl, oh, she's gone. Well, a man throws a word to her, she flirts with him, and instead of going with the other ladies to do her business, she goes differently to a part of the desert or the Sahara or the thing there. And of course, the predator will think, oh my God, she's giving me a sign, I gotta follow her. That was what they did at that time. So the sex predators used to wait for these women at the end of the day. And this became a big problem. And this became a huge problem for everybody, even the messenger himself. And it is because of this very reason that Allah revealed one of the very famous ayat, which talks to women about their dress code. But of course, our sheikh, what they did, they took this timed ayah, not timeless. It doesn't apply all the time. It just applied at that time there. And they made the ayah an eternity ayah. And that's why women have to wear the hijab all the time, when in fact, they shouldn't have. And before telling you the ayah that Allah revealed, I want to say this. Not much has changed for the Arabs for the last 1,000 years until now. Women are still unsafe anywhere in the Arab world than anywhere else. And I'll give you a small example. Women in Saudi Arabia, in Bahrain, United Arab Emirates, in Qatar, and all these things cannot go outside by themselves. Why? Because, like in Saudi Arabia, women are kidnapped, they are raped. It's incredible what happens there. That's why they have all these stingy restrictions. Like in Saudi Arabia, women cannot drive it. It's only in the last couple of years that they allow that. Why? Because of this fear that women will be kidnapped, snatched, and abused sexually. Now, if you move a little bit to the east, you go to Egypt, women have more freedom. Why? Because the Egyptians are not Arabs. The Egyptians are Amazigh, they are Coptic, they are not Arabs. It's Islam, it's the armies that made them speak Arabic and turned them, forced them to be who they are. So women there are a little bit more free. You go, for example, to Tunisia. Tunisia women are even more freer. Why? Because Tunisia are not Arabs at all. You go to Algeria, women have certain freedom also. And you go to Morocco, the same thing. So the more you run away from the Arab world, the safer women are. And this was the case in Al-Madinah back in time, at the time of the messenger. So now back to what Allah has revealed. Allah says, Ya Ayyuhan Nabi, speaking to the Prophet. You see, when Allah speaks to the Prophet, is different when he speaks to the messenger. When he orders the messenger, when he instructs the messenger, Allah is talking through him to humanity. When Allah talks to the Prophet, he is talking to Muhammad as an individual who lives in Al-Madinah. It's not for me, it's not for you, and it's not for the generations that came after him. It's man of religion that turned this, you the prophet, into you the messenger. And on the judgment day, they will see. But anyhow, O you prophet, قل لأزواجك وبناتك ونساء المؤمنين, tell your spouses, your daughters, and the women of the believers. You see, the spouses, his daughters, and to the women of the believers. What would the messenger tell them? يُدْنِينَ عَلَيْهِنَّ مِنْ جَلَابِيبِهِنَّ, that they should bring their outer garments. And this outer garment is the external robe the Arabs use to protect themselves, their dresses, their pants, their everything, from the harshness of the sand and the dry land around them. So Allah tells them to bring these garments, these outer garments, near to them. Why? Simple. When a Muslim woman would go, when women would go out for their business, either to buy something or predominantly to go to their business, to their toilet business, Allah instructs them to wear an extra layer. Why? Because those predators, the sex predators, read too much into things. If a woman, just for her necessity, was wearing light brown, and she comes out, they go, oh, she's wearing light brown because she wants to attract us. Let's go and hit on her. The lady, the poor lady, and remember, back in time, they didn't have tailors, they didn't have fashion, they didn't have sewing machines. So they would wear what they can, and the ability to wear what they wanted is very limited, color-wise or dress size. To them, They take a piece of cloth, cut a hole on the top, cut a couple holes on the right for the hands and the top for the head, and that's that. So these predators, they read into just like in our times, if a woman wears some skirts, short skirts, maybe she wears them because she finds herself attractive in it, and that's that. But some people would think, this woman is looking for debauchery or promiscuity or for sex or things like that. So some people read too much into things. To cut this pathway, Allah orders the Prophet to tell his wives, his daughters, and the ladies, the believer ladies, not everybody except the people who believed in Muhammad and the Quran that Allah had sent it, to bring down on them their outer garment. And then Allah justifies this order. You see, when Allah, but you know, it's another topic for another day. Allah didn't need to justify why he's doing this, but he told them why Allah orders them to bring their outer garment on them to cover themselves. This reason has completely been taken away from Muslim women. The sheikhs never speak about this. The reason why Allah orders the wives of the believers, the daughters of the messenger, the prophet, sorry, the spouses and everything, is that ذَلِكَ أَدْنَى أَن يُعَرَفْنَ فَلَا يُؤْذَيْنَ. When they dress, when they bring their garments and they cover themselves completely, Allah says that is more likely that they will be recognized and not be harassed. Recognized? Meaning, what do you mean, Ya Allah? It's simple. Ladies in Al-Madina, at the end of the day, you know women how they are. They're not like us men. We men, we can just go stand against a tree and pee. It's a lot of them, how we are wired is completely, it's sometimes, we are so volatile in every aspect. Just go to the tree and pee, end of it, or squat there and pee, that's fine. A woman, you'd kill her. She'll never do, even if she needs the toilet 1000%, you'll never see a woman squat around the bush and pee. That's just not in her nature. Allah didn't wire her like that. Fine. What women used to do, they used to bear the whole day, waiting until things get dark, and then they would leave. And you see a bunch of women going and spreading in the desert, just to respond to the call of nature, go to the toilet. So Allah says to the Prophet, tell those specific people that A, is your wives, B, your daughters, C, those who believed in you and the message of the Quran, to add an extra layer to protect themselves. When they do that, the believers who read the Quran would know that these women aren't up for grabs. You cannot hit on them. So the reason to wear a hijab, or not hijab, but to cover themselves, was so that people would recognize them and not hunt them down for sex. Strange thing is, this is in Surah Al-Ahzab, in the same Surah 33 and the Ayah 59. So it's part of the package that speaks about the Salat of Allah on the Messenger and the angels and everything. And this ayah doesn't mean at all that women would need to start wearing hijab. It's a lie. And women are paying a heavy price. I see them in the heat, how they sweat. Oh, God Almighty. When I was married and my wife come home, I didn't want to, oh God, she would go and take shower. Now imagine 1400 years ago, they didn't have shower. Sometimes the poor lady, women cannot wear perfume. So when she goes out, she can't wear perfume. But when she sweats, she has to stink. Her husband is next to her. And guess what? Right next to me in my car, we are driving. I have a human being that doesn't wear perfume and is stinking like a pig. How attractive is that woman to me? Not attractive at all. Women in the hadithic Islam have been designed not to be attractive at all. That's it. She stinks, she does that, that's fine. And that's the price women have to pay for not believing in the Quran. Because if I was a woman, I swear to Allah, I would not wear the hijab. If I knew back in time what I know now, my daughters would never ever have covered not their hair nor wear their hijab. Because that's not what Allah is asking. What Allah asks is just the modesty when we dress. So the wives of the Prophet were also, as I said, victims of this type of crime, sexual predators and things like that. So Allah suggested to them, when they go out and the daughters of the message and the believers to wear an outer robe, some garment, some kimono or cape, or it's just something that would differentiate. It's like having a flag on their hands. We are believers, we are not up for grabs. Well, at that time they didn't have it, and it'd just be funny that women would be carrying something in their hands. So Allah tells them, wear something that is different, and those predators would recognize you. You would think that the people would know who Muhammad was in that time, right? And that being the messenger of Allah, his status would demand respect and outer consideration, right? But that wasn't the case. Many of the believers, believe it or not, many of the believers, a huge number of them, didn't show the Prophet the respect he deserved. The Shaykh lied to us, the scholars lied to us when they say the companions would die for the Prophet. Lie, the Quran doesn't say that. So much so that Allah had to tell them to respect his messenger. Would you believe that? Allah had to descend Quran to demand respect for his messenger. The big majority of the believers lacked utter respect towards the Prophet. Look at what Allah tells them. لا تجعلوا دعاء الرسول بينكم كدعاء بعضكم بعض. Do not make the calling of the messenger between yourselves like the way you call one another. And this is in Surah An-Nur 24 and the ayah 28. You know why? Because people used to address the Prophet like they would address each other. Respect is like you go to your uncle and you call him by name. In any culture, there is always Uncle Joe, Uncle Khaled, Uncle this. You put a title before that. At the time of the messenger, they would address him just like they would address each other, until Allah told them, don't do it. Respect him. Call him different. Treat him different. My dear sisters and my brothers, the Quran is full of the believers' misbehaviors towards the Quran. And the lowest they reached was to chase his wives for sex. It's incredible. Some of them would flirt with them. There were actually some of the believers that were planning on marrying the wives of the messenger after his death. People used to know that XYZ of that man has his eyes on that wife of the messenger. So when he dies, he would go and marry her. So that's why Allah revealed in the Quran that the wives of the messenger are haram to marry, and they are like our mothers. That's the only reason why Allah revealed that. Once the messenger die, ain't nobody that's gonna sleep with one of his wives. Of course, as usual, the men of religion tried to play down this evil by saying, oh, you know what? It was only one man. It was only one man who wanted to marry one of the Prophet's wives. And by saying this, you know what? They accused Allah of being untruthful. Because as we shall see a bit later, Allah said that there were many and not just one. But as usual, the sheikhs, the men of religion, these big shaitans, what they did, they made Allah lie all this to defend what Al-Bukhari said and what this book of history said and what that said. So now I'm going to tell you the story behind the ayah 56 and how it came to be and what it really means. And I will say it in the next installment, so we start a fresh. Okay, to the next talk, inshallah. This is your brother Abdus Salam, and to the next one. Assalamu alaikum, to part number 4.